quiet on the set.
All quiet on the set. We're about to go live.
Did you want to sit, Judy?
No, because I'm trying to still...
All right, guys, I'm going live now. All quiet on the set. Hello, everybody. Kevin Luther here with Voluptuary and Lucid Wines. We are here live for another live virtual tasting, our summertime barbecue theme. So, wait. Making sure I have the right beer here. And I have Zach joining me again today to taste on air live with us through our awesome lineup again today. So thanks for joining again, Zach.
Yeah, cheers. Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's wonderful to have someone to drink with. You know, drinking alone is okay, but much more fun with friends and much more fun virtually with a big crowd of friends. So it's always good times. And normally I have Jerome on, my brother Jerome, on air live with me. But today Jerome is outside barbecuing with a summertime barbecue theme. Growing up, we were known for our barbecues and Jerome's leaning in on the left side there. I don't know if you caught him on cam there, but he's outside barbecuing, and he's doing pairings. If you guys didn't check it out already, we posted on Facebook, Instagram, and the website his barbecue pairings he's doing tonight. So really cool pairings for these wines, and if you got those things and you want to cook along, he's going to give some suggestions today as we taste and as he cooks. And we're also going to be eating this on air, so if you aren't barbecuing at home, then we're going to be making you really jealous and hungry. But it's going to be good times either way. So, yeah, crack out your wines here. We've got our nice lineup again. As usual, we have a five-wine lineup. And this week, we're tasting through two different whites. Technically, both of them are orange wines. Our L1 Skin Contact White Blend. And then we also have our L2 Urban Flora Rosé as our second wine. And then we go back to another orange wine. This one quite orange, our V3 The Lover Picpoul Blanc. Then we have two reds, our L3 Manifesto Barbera and our L4 Ripen Zinfandel. Those are two of our reds that are, you know, really fruit forward and fun red wines, and therefore just really good barbecue pairings. And I think whites and rosés and oranges do particularly well as food pairing options because they have so much going on with them. So yeah, that being said, you can pour that first wine, the L1 Skin Contact, but before we launch into that wine, I'm just going to give you a super brief intro. If you guys don't know who we are Voluptuary and Lucid Wines. We're based here in Sacramento, California, and we're a tiny winery. I launched this as a side project initially. I went to school for winemaking, traveled the world doing winemaking, ran other wineries and built them up for about 15 years. And then this was my experimental side project to focus on organic and natural wines, as well as experimental wines with aging on alternative woods, wild fermentations, really cool terroir of cool vineyard sources. And this was just a fun side project that just took off so strongly, I essentially quit my day job, which was making wine for other people. So I went from wine to wine, but able to focus on things that were really meaningful to me with Voluptuary, which is my fully organic wines, super experimental small production, and Lucid, which is my natural wines that are largely organic but not certified, and in many ways just a little bit more fruit forward and easy drinking, less extreme flavors and experimental stuff. So, you know, two brands just to express different parts of my winemaking, but both based locally here, both sourcing from local vineyards and making it all in this tiny warehouse we're in here. We have a 1,000-square-foot warehouse. I have about 80 barrels a year I make. The first vintages were even less, and we are amongst the tiniest wineries in the U.S. So thank you all for supporting. Thank you all for joining us live here, as well as for getting these tasting kits, because this just means all the world. With COVID and everything, I didn't know if we'd survive through these hard times, but by selling these virtual tasting kits, you know, these virtual tastings and our mini tasting kits that you guys are doing, it's kept us alive. It's kept us thriving through this time. So thank you all. Cheers. So pour that first wine in your glass. And actually, you were going to do the kits here, so I'll pass these kits along to you. And this first wine is our L1 Skin Contact Chardonnay Blend. It is a Chardonnay base with a little bit of Malvasia Bianca, which is a more rare white grape. Chardonnay, most people know, kind of gives you your pear, peach, apple flavors. Malvasia Bianca is related to Muscat and is a little more tropical fruit and floral notes, so it just adds a pinch of that. And then this wine is called Skin Contact because I ferment it on the skins. And that skin contact is, some people call it orange wine or golden wine. It's an ancient technique of fermenting a white grape like a red wine on the skins. And it gives you a wine that has more aromatics as well as just a little more intensity on the palate. So, give that a taste. And you're gonna get a lot of bright fruit. Like I said, all these orchard, tropical, floral kind of components, but also a citrus note. I think I get like, you know, riper citrus, but still like some mandarin or oranges or something.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and this one is organically grown grapes from, mostly from Bocage Vineyards in Lodi, but also some of the Chardonnay and the Malvasia is from Contra Costa County, from a really cool organic and biodynamic vineyard down there, Ergolette Vineyard. So Julian Ergolette, great farmer, really cool guy. And yeah, so that's the grapes that went into that. I already told you a little bit about that skin contact technique. And then I aged the wine for about 6 months in oak, but mostly used oak. So there's not a big oak flavor. Normally oak will give you stuff like vanilla and coconut and a smokiness. You might get a little bit of that, mostly the vanilla coconut, but it doesn't dominate. It just lifts that fruit, you know? And then, yeah, filtered it and bottled it. Pretty straightforward. With most of my wines, they are natural and organic grapes, fermented and then aged on mostly neutral oak, occasionally some new oak, which the new oak is where you get most of the big flavor, but also sometimes other woods, like in this case, there was a little bit of lemon wood. And then here we have Jerome here, bringing in, on a related note, some lemons and oysters, it looks like.
Yeah, so touching on what Kevin said, having the lemon wood in it, it makes it a natural pairing with lemon. And these are some Meyer lemons my mom scavenged. Hey, Mom. She's here in the audience. And some Kumamoto oysters. They're the smallest, but they're the sweetest. They've got the best, like, minerality. They're my favorites. So just have some fresh local oysters, or, you know, I got them from Sunfish, but they're from the bay. And some Meyer lemons. I think this is a really good pairing for this. I'll be bringing in another one shortly. I'm out grilling some potatoes for a potato salad, but this is something that everyone can do. You might need help shucking the oysters, but it's going to be a good pairing with this and just delicious. So,
yeah, I'll be back. Jerome, so in addition to quite obviously, well fairly obviously, growing up together, Jerome and I as brothers, we're always, you know, companions in Jerome barbecue. And I was an okay cook, but Jerome was the cook in the family. And
I can't make wine for shit though, so he's still
yeah, exactly. So I'm the wine making side of things now. Obviously when we were kids I wasn't making wine, but over the years we lived next to each other in a duplex that I was on one side and he was on the other side. And I'd come home from a day of winemaking and he'd have made me dinner. And then I'd be like, well, you want a bottle of this experimental wine I just created? And he's like, deal. So we'd swap, you know, I'd always be able to get good food and he'd have the good wine. And so now that I've got this winery launched, it's become a thing that we're adding to things. Yeah, so we're going to have some of our studio audience here, our cousin Carrie grabbing some oysters. And we've also got, like I mentioned, my mom here. She's going to pop up, slide around the back there, Mom. And we also have Aaron Lincoln. You guys have seen him on previous shows.
You can do it.
With his girlfriend Ruby J doing live music performances. And they're a great duo together. But then Aaron is performing solo tonight, doing a really cool song for us. So he'll be coming on after the second wine. So we're going to get a little wine in you guys first, and then we'll roll into some music. Once I always feel music is better when you're a couple drinks in. So we'll do that. Yeah, oysters are good, huh?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So I'm going to check my I have my notes on your side, actually.
Ah, there we go. Hiding back there.
So make sure I didn't miss anything here. Yeah, as I've mentioned various things about this wine. And, oh, yes, I have my quirky pairings I do every week with the wines.
So we do food pairings, and as Jerome has already mentioned, we pair oysters with this wine. But I also do life pairings. So this one is spring and summertime, hanging out with your friends, relaxing by yourself in the evening. You know, this is a good starter for a barbecue. It's a laid-back, fun white wine. Although it's an orange wine, which tend to be heavier whites, I don't think this one's heavy at all. It's more crisp and refreshing and citrus-based. So my music pairing for this matches that brightness. It is I'm Alive by Michael Franti. Super upbeat song, just about amped about being alive and you know, in the sunshine and stuff like that.
Definitely.
So yeah, so then my literary pairing for this is from Paulo Coelho, The Alchemist, his book, The Alchemist. And the quote is, "When we love, we always strive to become better than we are. When we strive to become better than we are, everything around us becomes better too." Really great book. I mentioned this during the circus show a couple of weeks ago. This was a pairing I did as well. And it's just such a deep book about living your life to the fullest and following your own personal path, whatever that may be. Check out that book if you haven't read that. Actually, we surreptitiously inspired my mom to reread that book, which she's read parts of in the past. So she's rereading that. You guys should too. And well, other than the oysters, one of my food pairings for this is a white sauce pasta, because while fish or oysters with citrus is a really straightforward, obvious pairing, I think, because seafood, citrus, crisp white wine, especially with sort of citrus flavors, makes a lot of sense. I also think that richer stuff like roasted cauliflower, cheeses, or white sauce pastas, by being a little creamier, then pairing with something, a wine that's a little more citrusy, you, rather than enhancing the innate tendency of the food as you do when you have oysters and citrus with a citrusy wine, you kind of counterpoint it. You have something creamier, and then you have a wine that's a little more crisp, and it's like adding a seasoning to the dish.
Yep.
Do you have any thoughts on this wine or on some music pairings or anything? Some food pairings you'd suggest?
No, just to like feed off of what you're saying, it's like that fun thing on having that counter aspect where, you know, it's really nice to have the wine be that countering where it's like, oh, that was a really rich bite. And then you go in, you have that sip and you're like, oh, I'm ready for that next bite. And you're just like that fun give and pull. And also with the oysters, it's awesome. Like the salinity of it, that little bit of salt plays with the acidity of that wine. So it's just like this perfect little combination. Like if you eat a pickle and a French fry, it's that same thing where it just lifts those flavors together. Mm-hmm. So it's, like you were saying, opposite sides of that spectrum. It's really fun.
I went for my beer after oyster and I'm like, wait, I have to do the wine. So yeah, that does work well. Mm-hmm. But I think you touched on a subject there that a lot of people at home, if you're thinking, oh, cool, I love the food pairings they're suggesting, but then it's like you just learned one thing, like, ooh, this wine with oysters. Cool, now I know that. But how do you expand that beyond that base knowledge? Learning wine and food pairing is based on a couple of core concepts and then also just trying it. Mm-hmm. So one concept is matching like with like. And so that's like citrusy wine with citrusy food. Another one is counterpointing, where you have something in a dish that's maybe too extreme, like creaminess or fattiness, and counterpointing that with an almost an opposite thing in the wine, where it's the citrus, the acidity is cutting through the creaminess or richness of the dish. Mm-hmm. Or almost it's like a spice you're adding to the dish. It's like a chef can pair with a dish that is lacking something by adding a wine that has that as a pairing. But talking about cutting through the fattiness, that's one of the core other things is, from a flavor perspective, acidity in wine, literally on a chemical level, on a chemistry level, molecular level, cuts through those oils. It actually like helps break them down and remove them from the coating of your mouth and tongue, which actually makes you better able to take a next taste and fully perceive the flavors. So it actually makes sense beyond just like conceptually or historically or culturally. Like there's actually science behind it. And, but I mean, go anywhere in the world and they'll see the same thing. There's a reason why Europeans, they might have their aperitif, they might have their beer, but with food, most Europeans, Italians, French, Spanish, drink wine with food. And it's because wine just does so well in food pairing because of that acidity.
Well, it's also kind of an interesting thing too, like the modern phenomenon of drinking wine on its own is very new. Like traditionally, most oftentimes people would only drink wine mm-hmm. with food. So it's fun seeing like the expanse of different styles of wine where, you know, kind of touching on that fatty, rich pasta with, mm-hmm. you know, this mm-hmm. wine, for instance, it's like the same classic pairing of fatty ribeye with a really intense Cabernet or something.
Yeah.
Like on its own, like you might not want to drink that Cabernet because it's just like, just puckers your mouth up with the tannins. But, you know, once you get that fat,
yeah,
it creates that synergy where you're just like, oh, this is heaven.
and on the flip side, this is a reason why oftentimes if you're tasting a wine where you're going like, why do people like, you know, a lot of new wine drinkers go, why do people like wine or like this style of wine? Acidic wines, really tannic or bitter wines are oftentimes not favored by new wine drinkers because oftentimes they're drinking them by themselves and they're maybe not acclimated to the acidity or tannic, astringent, bitter flavors of those kind of wines. But when tasting them by themselves, they're kind of intense at first until you get used to it. But it's like drinking bitter beer. You get used to it and then you like it as a standalone. But in the meantime, one of the core reasons that wine was made that way was because it was traditionally consumed with food. And mm-hmm. since food eases up the perception of those flavors and melds with them nicely,
yep.
they just make sense together. So it's like those wines that don't seem to make sense by themselves, it's probably because they need food. Yep. And they were, that kind of winemaking was traditionally combined with food. So,
yep.
yeah. So cool. All right. That is the first wine. We're going to roll right into the second wine here. And feel free to help, you know, finish off your plate of oysters. We'll be rolling into the next pairing here in a second.
If you want to flip out here, I can finish it up.
Perfect, perfect. So we're going to pop the camera over to Jerome to talk about his next dish to go with the second wine. So the second wine is going to be our L2 Urban Flora Rosé.
This is another one for the L1.
Oh. Okay, well, we'll let him talk about the pairings out there. About he's going to have one more for the L1, and then he'll probably talk a little bit about pairings for the L2 as well. This is the L2 Urban Flora Rosé. Really fruit-forward, watermelon, strawberry, cherry. It's a darker style rosé. A little bit of citrus as well still, because it's quite refreshing and fruit-forward again. But pour that one in your glass. You can start tasting that, or you know, also listen to the rest of his pairing options, and we'll be right back to talk more about the wine.
Lemons that I used for there, and I dented those with juice.
So it's all looking good, though. It's all looking good
overall. The other two ingredients for that,
the blue cheek,
the next one, are some mayonnaise. I know not everybody's favorite, but
I love mayonnaise.
It is delicious. And about equal amounts of sour cream. And if you don't like sour cream or don't like mayonnaise, there are other substitutes. You can do Greek yogurt. You can do just one or just the other. But 50-50 of these two is my personal favorite.
Yes, it's all be working.
See how it sounds.
Yeah, I just checked. It's all working.
So I'm pretty sweet with the windy out here. It's just blowing away a little. Just give this a nice mix.
I'm thinking maybe let's flip sides, actually, I think. Sorry. Yeah. It's easier for me. I was...
Yeah, you can slide under. All right, cool. We'll do that.
That's a little awkward.
Rotate.
right, I believe we're back on here. So, yeah, that's thank you, Jerome, for breaking down some food pairings. And ooh, I lost my the watermelon rind is disconnected for me. Wow, that's cool.
Fancy. All right, well. Thank you, Jerome.
Thank you, everybody.
Good stuff. So, Jerome does some amazing stuff in the kitchen. Wow, I just got to take a moment to enjoy that.
All right.
Yeah, that's such a good mix. Watermelon and mint are one of those flavor pairings that's like, there's an inherent, innate thing. It's like, why do watermelon and mint go so well together? They just do. It's like, in their bones. So this wine, L2 Urban Flora Rosé, is largely based in Barbera, actually in this new vintage, and you guys are now tasting the new vintage, has a little bit of Pinot Noir in there as well. And overall on this wine, you are getting a really heavily watermelon, strawberry, cherry kind of fruit flavor. And that obviously pairs so well with this. But a lot of that comes from the fact that this is a darker style rosé, what they call a Saunier rosé. I left it on the skins a little longer than most winemakers would do a rosé. And that extra time on the skins extracts some of that skin color, so you get a little darker, you know, pink to light red color. And then you also get more reddish flavors, pink and red flavors. You know, watermelon, strawberry, cherry, which is why one of the reasons watermelon does so well with it. So Saunier, meaning giving that skin contact and then draining or bleeding off the juice. So you just have a little color extraction and then you separate that juice. Then I will put it in one of these barrels and ferment it in the oak. Now, if it was new oak, you would get a lot of oaky flavors, but it wasn't new oak, it was used oak. So you get very, very subtle. If anything, a pinch of vanilla and coconut that help lift that fruit, but mostly let the focus remain on the fruit. But then also the fact that it's in the barrel fermenting, after the fermentation, the yeast fall to the bottom of the barrel, and I would go back in and stir that up. Now, you know, it's like almost like a souffle technique where you can really bring out a creaminess and you smooth out the wine by stirring back in the yeast. They call it Sur Lees, aging. Lees just referring to the yeast in French, and batonnage is the stirring process. It sounds a lot fancier when I say, oh, we had Sur Lees aging with batonnage, rather than saying, yeah, I mixed the dead yeast in the barrel, and it tastes delicious. So if you say it in French, it sounds cool. So so yeah, that's just, any other thoughts on that in terms of that technique or the wine?
No, you pretty much nailed it.
So yeah. That's the gist of it there. My life pairing with this is sunset drinks with friends, hanging at the beach, festival life. Obviously, not a whole lot of festivals going on right now. And hanging at the beach is largely frowned upon at the moment. So these pairings aren't very applicable at the moment. But we are definitely starting to open up. So who knows? Maybe we can do these things again soon. But safely, at 6 feet distance. Then music pairings. We have Lamar by Beautiful Girls and Lazy Afternoon by Revolution. Just chill reggae, kind of, you know, laid back music. And literary pairing for this, I have Tom Robbins' Jitterbug Perfume. And this quote is from that book, and it is, "Never underestimate how much assistance, how much satisfaction, how much comfort, how much soul and transcendence there might be in a well-made taco and a cold bottle of beer." It's a very deep book, and that's but he's also very good at keeping things, you know, like being deep while also just being down to earth. Like, yeah, sometimes, that's, yeah.
Definitely one of my happy places is just a good taco. It's hard not to smile when you're just like, yep, this is perfect.
Right? And that's one of the major risks of my existence here. I make wine in a warehouse that's amongst this whole industrial lot. And we're making wine in the middle of nowhere, but there is a really good taco truck about a block away. And it's been really dangerous because I pretty much eat there every day now. So, you know, Jerome's really taking care of the food pairings.
I will mention these first two wines you can find locally here in Sacramento. The Federalist, Sackyard also has this rosé, and the Sacramento Natural Foods Co-op also has this rosé and the white, and our L8 Wanderlust red blend as well. So without further ado, you know, I think we're going to have our musical guest on here. Aaron's going to pop on here, and we'll pop off and let him take over. And I'll let him do a little introduction for himself and his music. So thanks for joining us, Aaron.
Thank you.
Hey there. My name's Aaron Lincoln. I'm thrilled to be here, especially on food day. I haven't been able to eat any yet, but once I'm done singing, I'll cheers to these fellas here. I'm a songwriter and singer around town here. I have been for a lot of years. In light of the light, summery, grilling kind of event we have going on today, I chose this song that I wrote a number of years ago with the same kind of vibe. Can you look into your eyes, past the glistening white, through the cracks into your mind and find out what's inside? I can. I found my sweet dream, lady. Let me have sweet dreams tonight. And if I find you sleeping here, then that's all. When I wake up in the morning, every time I look you around, look into your eyes, it breaks me down. And past the is where I want to be, so I through the cracks into your mind and find out what's inside. Things I've seen, so be all my sweet things. I slip away into my dreams, my sweet dreams. I find you sleeping in the air, sweet dreams. When I wake up in here, then that's alright. This is my sweet dream, lady. Let me have sweet dreams tonight. If I find you sleeping here, then that's alright. You bring me here on one tale of mischief, lightning quick reactions to your words. 10 hours seem like 2, and something is right here between me and you, yeah. Well, I'm stuck on high wire, there you are way down below, and I can't seem to get to you, because when I fall, I don't fall, so when I'd love to hold you in my arms and sweetly, deeply in your eyes, but I don't think that'll happen, because when I tried, I slipped and died from my sweet dream, lady. Let me have sweet dreams tonight. And if I find you sleeping here, then that's alright. Yes, you're my sweet dream, lady. Let me have sweet dreams tonight. And if I find you sleeping here, then that's alright. You bring me here on the tail of mischief. Lightning quick reactions to your words. 10 hours seem like 2. Something is right in between me and you. Make love tonight. If I'm not crazy, then baby, then you'll see that I love you. I love you. I love my sweet, yeah. Sweet dream, lady. Let me have sweet dreams tonight. And if I find you sleeping here, then that's alright. Yes, you're my sweet dream, lady. Let me have sweet dreams tonight. And if I find you sleeping here, then that's alright. Alright. Love tonight, from the crazy.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Aaron. All right. We'll swap out here. How's it going, everybody? So, all right. Thank you again, Aaron. That was awesome. Having only heard you singing previously, you know, backing up, with Ruby, and she has such a beautiful voice as well. And I was like, oh, he's got a cool backup voice. But like hearing you perform by yourself is like, oh, holy crap. Yeah. Okay. No. Yeah. You're definitely good standalone. That was amazing. So those first two wines were Lucid wines. I want to throw out one, speaking of local artists, and Aaron is a local artist here in Sacramento. Our Lucid art is all from local artist Micah Crandall-Bear. You know, we like to keep it local and keep it, connected and community-based. He's someone that we went to school with. He was willing to let us use his art for our labels. And he's just blown up internationally now. So check out Micah Crandall-Bear. Really beautiful art. Now you can pull out your third bottle of wine or sampler kit of wine and pour that. We have our V3 The Lover Picpoul Blanc. Now this Picpoul Blanc itself, just first of all, is a rare grape variety from the south of France that is most known for making really kind of insipid, simple wines. There's nothing wrong with it. It's just a simple white wine. So I chose this as a wine to do really crazy experimental stuff with to show how much technique can change the flavor of a wine. And in this case, this is really extreme technique. This is skin contact style, but 200% skin contact. It is its own skins, just like the first one, whole berry, with skins from another Picpoul Blanc I made thrown in for 200% skin contact. So this wine has a lot of dark, rich, almost dried or candied kind of orchard fruits, tropical fruits, floral notes, really dried characteristics. And it starts to get into these almost red wine palate characteristics because it was fermented on the skins like a red wine, aged in oak like a red wine. So I'm going to dive into that a little bit more, but before we do too much on that, I believe we're going to have Jerome talk about these next pairings. So I'm going to let him take over and tell you guys about his next barbecue pairings, and I'm going to sneak some food while you're gone.
things that you have around. And I'm going to smear a little butter on those. So it's going to be almost like little home run pies or like an apple pie, but like a barbecue version. So you'll just have it kind of folded up, eat it like a taco, and it will pair with all of those orchard fruit pastry notes in there. I'll have a second pack as well for the bakery, but that'll come a little later. And I'm going to smear a little butter on those. Let me finish this up and
bring it in.
So it's going to be almost like back to you guys in the studio. Pies or like an apple pie, but like a barbecue version. So you'll just have it kind of folded up, eat it like a taco, and it will pair with all of those orchard fruit.
All right, are we back on? Okay, cool. So thank you again, Jerome, for some awesome food pairings again. He talked more about it out there, but we got this beautiful cucumber salad here. I believe Thai inspired. So he does some really cool influence from Thailand in a lot of his cooking. We've done some.
All right, are we back on? Okay, cool.
So thank you again, Jerome, for some and awesome if you missed any food details, I understand
there's been some quiet audio talks there.
More about it out there. We've got the beautiful page. Cucumber we salad here. I believe Thai inspired.
You can scope out some of the details there.
Some really cool influence so from
that wine.
From Thailand,
as usual, he killed cooking. It with food pairing.
All right, we also got on. Okay, cool. So, thank you again, Jerome, for some awesome food pairings again.
There's been some quiet audio there
about it out there. We got the beautiful flavor here. Thai inspired,
from Bocas.
Really cool in 2017
wine.
From Thailand, as usual, he killed it with food pairings.
All right,
we also got on. Okay, cool. So, thank you again, Jerome, for some awesome. She bedazzled it basically and turned it into a beautiful bouquet. So, yeah, really neat thing. We'll have that on display in our tasting room.
Oh, yeah. If you're getting background noise from the music, you'll have to turn off the system audio.
So, sorry if there was a little bit of background noise there. We've improved a lot of our technology around here. But the more complicated the technology gets, the more opportunity for issues there are. So we've learned that there is this setting we have to turn on and off throughout the broadcast so you can hear Jerome, but then at the same time not hear our other music that we have in the system. So sorry if there was a little bit of background music there.
We were kind of chuckling about it earlier. It's like Star Trek in here. We have about like 7 screens going and 2 different cameras. It's ridiculous, but that's 2020 for you, right?
Right. And I'm a winemaker. I've never been a very techie guy. And launching this thing amidst COVID, I thought I was going to just pour wine here at this counter. And, you know, I know how to do that pretty well. But setting up our website and Facebook and YouTube for live streaming with a webcam, with, you know, audio and a secondary video source, which is more or less what you have to do to pull off live streaming in the modern era. You know, it can get pretty crazy and complicated.
which is, I think, a good segue into mentioning another cool thing that I haven't really announced yet, so you guys are the first to hear it. We are launching our in-person tasting room. So physical, actual wine tasting. You guys can come out and visit us here at the Warehouse Winery. We are a micro winery, like I mentioned, 1,000 square feet. What you see here, this bar, slab of wood on two wine barrels, is basically it. And it's about twice this long. But that is the tasting bar. Pop in here. We're in an industrial district next to a brewery and a steel working place. If you need anything fabricated out of steel, then, you know, one-stop shop. And then you can pop in and taste some wine as well. It's a, I think, what I like about it and the reason why I launched it in such a, you know, non-traditional winery context is you can just pop in here and taste wine with me. And, you know, Zach's going to be helping out. Drum's going to be helping out. But you're going to be here with us and tasting through the wines in the place it's made. I mean, literally, barrels full of wine are behind the bar. And it's just down to earth and fun and laid back. And it's, you know, you go to Napa, you go to fancy wineries, and it's all about the show. It's all about the high-end experience where they're showing off their money to you. I don't have money to show off, and I wouldn't want to if I had it. It's, I just, you know, I want to share wine I made with you guys. And so roll by our warehouse, check it out on the website, our Facebook, Google, whatever, it's everywhere. We now have the new hours and our address, Wednesday through Friday, 11 a.m. to 7 p.m., and then Saturday, 11 to 3, because we have to close down by 3 in order to be ready to go live for this. So, yeah, you can come by, taste. We're going to be practicing all the COVID health things according to WHO, CDC, and our local government, as well as the Wine Institute. All of those suggestions we are taking into account and making sure to practice safe distancing and, yeah, all the important things. So that way you can taste wine safely. We have a little outside seating as well. So, yeah, you can still join us every Saturday night, of course. But if you do want to come taste and see the spot, roll by. On that note, let's roll into the next wine, huh?
Sweet. I love it. Cool. Do we want to check in with Jerome on some of the pairings for the Picpoul Blanc?
Yes.
Yeah.
We'll do that. And feel free, as he tells you those pairings, and then probably starts telling you the pairings for the next wine, to pour your next taste for yourself. This will be the L3 Manifesto Barbera. This is one of our lighter, lucid reds. It's dark in color and fruit flavor, but it's smooth and a little more acid-driven in its palate. So yeah, I'll let Jerome take it away and tell you about his food pairings for this wine. And hopefully we can nail the audio this time. The Manifesto Barbera. This is one of our lighter, lucid reds. It's dark in color and fruit flavor, but it's smooth and a little more acid-driven in its palate. So yeah, I'll let Jerome take it away and tell you about his food pairings for this wine. And hopefully we can nail the audio this time. The Manifesto Barbera. This is one of our lighter, lucid reds. It's dark in color and fruit flavor, but it's smooth and a little more acid-driven in its palate. So yeah, I'll let Jerome take it away and tell you about his food pairings for this wine. And hopefully we can nail the audio this time. The Manifesto Barbera. This is one of our lighter, lucid reds. It's dark in color and fruit flavor, but it's smooth and a little more acid-driven in its palate. So yeah, I'll let Jerome take it away and tell you about his food pairings for this wine. And hopefully we can nail the audio this time. The Manifesto Barbera. This is one of our lighter, lucid reds. It's dark in color and fruit flavor, but it's smooth and a little more acid-driven in its palate. So yeah, I'll let Jerome take it away and tell you about his food pairings for this wine. And hopefully we can nail the audio this time. The Manifesto Barbera. This is one of our lighter, lucid reds. It's dark in color and fruit flavor, but it's smooth and a little more acid-driven in its palate. So yeah, I'll let Jerome take it away and tell you about his food pairings for this wine. And hopefully we can nail the audio this time. The Manifesto Barbera. This is one of our lighter, lucid reds. It's dark in color and fruit flavor, but it's smooth and a little more acid-driven in its palate. So yeah, I'll let Jerome take it away and tell you about his food pairings for this wine. and hopefully we can nail the audio this time.
The Manifesto Barbera. This is one of our lighter, lucid reds. It's dark in color and fruit flavor, but it's smooth and a little more acid-driven in its palate. So yeah, I'll let Jerome take it away and tell you about his food pairings for this wine, and hopefully we can nail the audio this time. The Manifesto Barbera. This is one of our lighter, lucid reds.
Some weird audio feedback
on their webcam apparently created a total lack of audio up there and a loop that fucked up all the video and the audio.
Oh, that sucks.
Yeah, that's really weird. We'll have to do that again.
Wonder why it didn't do it on the first view.
I don't know. It's really weird. Yeah. It's somehow
good. Well, these are ready to go if you guys want to eat them. So,
going to inside, we're going to have you join in here to talk.
All right, that works.
Okay, so it seems like.
So you just toss some of those in a tortilla,
fold it up like a taco, and it's going to be almost like a little
apple pie.
Off back into the host scene. And Jerome, do you want to hop on and talk about the food with me, actually?
Did that go through at all, or no?
No. All right. So we're going to hop back in, and I'll reintroduce the wine, and we're going to introduce that.
Can you give me 10 seconds to wash my hands?
Yeah, I'll talk. All right.
Hello! All right.
It's truly live right now.
Yes. So we are back, and hopefully this is capturing us again now. Sorry again, technical difficulties. As I mentioned, I'm a pretty solid winemaker and not the most techie person in the world. Things happen. We're back. So now we are tasting the L3 Manifesto Barbera. This is a wine that has a lot of blackberry plum style fruit, darker fruit in color, but is overall smoother. It's lighter red wine in terms of its fruit characteristics, but a darker red wine, I'm sorry, lighter red wine in terms of its palate, but a darker red wine in terms of its fruit characteristics and color. So, okay.
I'm going to throw something on grill real quick. I just realized I need all my grill time.
Yeah, Jerome's going to be right back to talk about some pairings. But this wine is, like I say, Barbera from the Sierra Nevada foothills outside of Sacramento. And I'm going to pull my notes up here just to double check some stuff. But this wine, it's from a little bit lower elevation vineyard, about 700 feet in the foothills. So most of the foothills are fairly high elevation. This is slightly lower elevation. And so it has some good acidity, but also some very good ripe fruit. When you get really high elevation, sometimes the acidity is so strong that Barbera can be kind of a harsh wine. But I think this is overall fairly smooth with Barbera. And the fermentation on this, it is an organic and natural winemaking approach,
but I did use a little bit of quirky yeast. I started this natural, total wild fermentation, the yeast that exists on the grapes. But then as the fermentation continued, I added a little bit of Belgian beer yeast, non-saccharomyces, which is to say the kind of yeast that exist in wild fermentations. I added them, Belgian beer yeast, more or less a mix of probiotic yeast and bacteria to the fermentation to create a complexity of fermenting microbiota to mimic kind of the same sort of thing you see in a kombucha or a wild fermentation, but in a more extreme way. So it gives this wine, which was otherwise maybe a little too smooth and fruity, something a little bit more interesting and complex. And, yeah. You know, it's not too over the top, but you definitely do get a little bit of that.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, do you have a thought on that? Or?
Oh, no. Go ahead.
Jerome, you want to talk about your food pairings?
Yeah, and well, I don't think you guys heard the food pairings for the V3 The Lover because of the audio difficulties, so I'll go over those real quick. I described the grilled apples, which have just a little bit of brown sugar and cinnamon on it. You can use any kind of sugar and any kind of baking spice, and then just fold it up into a buttered tortilla. It makes a little, like, almost apple pie, like taco that you can have. Just hold it in your hand. That's why they call them a hand pie. The other one, which is just finishing up right now, is grilled some shrimp and just going to toss it in some garlic butter. Pretty simple, but with the lover, you have those real smooth, deep notes that the butter kind of accentuates and the garlic plays along with. And then, of course, seafood is going to be a good pairing for any kind of white. For this Barbera, as Kevin mentioned, it's got those stone fruit flavors, your plum, blackberry, your dark stone fruits. So I'm just literally going to throw some of those on the grill hole because they're really hard to split with the stone in the middle. And then also I've got some tofu grilling out there, and you could certainly use chicken or pork as well with cocoa, salt, and black pepper on it. And those cocoa notes are going to play real well, I hope, with the Barbera because it's got those nice, mild cocoa notes in the background along with the fruit. So I'm kind of trying to play off of that combination with these here. So that'll be coming in a minute. Again, I'm a few minutes behind the actual tasting on these. Without me on here rambling, this goes a little faster than I would have expected. But I'm going to go keep those moving. We do have a little help out there now, but I need to still keep things moving on the grill. So
I'll try and ramble more for you.
Yeah. So, all right. So now you can finish off this L3 Manifesto Barbera. All right. And pour your last wine of the evening. This is our L4 Ripen Zinfandel. So this last wine, there's the label and bottle, is a really...
And may I get that, Kevin? I'm actually going to pour that all over my mushrooms for that same course.
Ooh,
for
pairing, right? We're almost out of the bottle. So this wine is, to me, perhaps... I mean, I believe that's just one there... is perhaps our most fruit-forward wine we make, in a way. It's a very focused, intense blackberry flavor for me. Zinfandel, for me, the flavor it most captures is blackberry. And blackberry pie, in particular. So you get a lot of real ripe Zinfandel varietal character fruit here. Really, really jammy blackberry pie style. There's a little bit of spice here, but not over the top. It's more fruit focused, I think.
Mm-hmm. Well, what I like about it too is it has that really nice fruit forward element to it,
mm-hmm.
and it kind of settles into that like leasy taste afterwards. So it's like this nice little crescendo and then easing into that palate afterwards. So
yeah.
A really nice mouthfeel to it.
Exactly. Cause it does have that tannin and alcohol that are mm-hmm. at a fairly high level. So although you get a big fruit in the beginning, it definitely like does that crescendo, and then it mellows out, and it has a very long finish for an otherwise fruit-forward wine.
Yep.
So as opposed to the Barbera, which is like dark fruit in its aromas, but kind of light in its palate, this one is very, very fruit-forward in its aromas, but it's also very deep and heavy in its palate. It goes a very different direction with that.
And this is definitely what I would call like a complex wine, since you're having so many little nuances mm-hmm. come into your palate. It's not this linear experience. You start off with one flavor, it changes into those tannins and then into that last bit. And that's like a fun play with your palate.
Yeah. So that's one of my, this is more one of my more fun wines that I made for me. Some of my wines are
really eccentric, like that V through the lover. You know, some of them are just simple. This one is fun while still having a lot going on. So to me, it's like it has that nice mix and balance that not all of our wines are. Some of them are more fun, some are more complex. This, I think, has that middle ground, which is kind of cool. This is from the Sierra Nevada foothills, from Mann Vineyards. And I haven't talked about it too much today, but I age my wines on alternative woods in addition to oak. So the Barbera had a little bit of cherry and maple. The Zinfandel was all cherry, actually. And I think it adds, A, like cherry fruit flavors, but also a spice characteristic. You get some white pepper, you get some black pepper, and I think it enhances some of that complexity.
Definitely. And that's like a common characteristic a lot of people love about Zinfandels is that like peppery note that like plays with those tannins. And, you know, it's one of the things I love about your wines is just playing with those different woods. It's very unique to see. And oftentimes you'll just see American or French oak. And, you know, it's a very standardized flavor and you know it. But like these other woods are just fun to experience. It's just, very unique.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's something that, if you guys don't know this, if you haven't watched previous episodes where I've talked about this, I come from a woodworking family. Our uncle owned a woodworking shop, Steve. My oldest brother, Marcus, has his own business, Ambrose 852 Crafts, doing handcrafted wood products. My next oldest brother, John, runs a woodworking shop. He is an industrial design engineer creating high-end game room furniture, bars, and pool tables, and, you know, just whatever. And Jerome ran a woodworking shop too. And my cousin Carrie in the audience works at a woodworking shop. So it's just a big part of our family. And so it naturally came up when I became a winemaker. Why only oak? Why don't you use other woods? Other woods taste or smell amazing when you're sawing them. Other woods are awesome on the grill when you're barbecuing with them as a smoking agent. So why not use them in wine as a flavoring agent? Because barrels are both a vessel to hold your wine, but also a flavor component. And winemakers, you know, they don't like to talk about how much oak influences wine because they want to talk about the terroir and the grape variety and stuff, and it's good marketing. But all of them, I mean, the winemakers who talk most about terroir are oftentimes the worst in terms of actually using way excessive amounts of oak. And they're like, oh my God, this Cabernet Sauvignon has this beautiful vanilla, coconut, earthy, peppery flavor. And it's like, dude, you created that by adding 100% new oak. Like, that's not terroir. You're full of it. And a lot of winemakers talk about this like that's what they're actually doing, when meanwhile they're actually doing a totally different thing. So oak can be a really dominant flavor in a lot of wines. I don't use much oak in my wines. I don't use much of these other woods in my wines, for that matter. Yeah. But they're a seasoning. They're a way to add just a little complexity. And I'm upfront about it. I use some other woods. I use some oak, but just as a way to add complexity to the wine, not to take away from it, just to add complexity. So yeah, in this case, cherry. I mentioned earlier the lemon wood, and just a little bit here and there.
Yeah, and I just want to take a moment as well to praise both Kevin and Jerome, because I've been working here about a week and a half now and just helping with all the packaging logistics, and seeing the process that the two of them did to adapt to everything, just hitting the ground running, has been truly amazing to see. Like, these two guys have been putting in like 80 hours of work a week and constantly just adapting to every little thing and figuring out these packagings, making their own packaging system. If you see these coming to your house, they're making everything of that and repurposing like case boxes and styrofoam inserts that normally just go to waste at wineries. So just praise to you both for being very, very like progressive. Dude,
making me blush.
Yeah, it's awesome to see. So
it might be that the warehouse is really hot, but I feel like it's just blushing from the compliments. So on that note, that's a really good lead in to, I'm going to show you guys these kits that we have real quick. So let's pan over here. I'm going to slide around. And I want to show you guys real quick our tasting kits. Now, most of you tasting at home already know what you're looking at. These are our layers of, we've got some Singha here, that doesn't come with a kit, but we've got our layers of tasting options. So these are our small taster kits. It's $8 and you get 5 1-ounce small tasters. That is our most straightforward, easy option. You have about a glass of wine when it's all said and done.
This is our by the glass tasting kit. It's 3.4 ounces of each wine. It's a slightly small pour of wine. It's like, you know, almost a full glass of wine of each of the five wines. It adds up to about a little over three glasses of wine. And that is, you know, our most popular option since we released that a couple weeks ago. And lastly, we have our five bottle option. That is obviously the most wine, and it's the, it's more your family pack, you know, or two of you who really like drinking and really like our wine. That's a great way to support us. Now, another thing I want to point out, you notice screw caps here. These are twist top bottles. We were doing cork bottles before, and they were really popular and doing really well when we were mostly this tiny little local winery selling to local folks who were picking up or we were dropping off. Now, as summertime came and we started doing more and more people further afield, people ordering from all over the place and trying our kits, and also now it's hotter, we've done a couple of switches to ensure top quality. We've switched to screw cap bottles on all of our sizes, and then we're also refrigerating our wines down to 35 degrees before shipment, and then packaging them very effectively in some awesome bubble wrap and insulation, so they're double insulated, and we ship them with dry ice. So now you have this cold wine being shipped in a way that remains cold, and we've also switched to, no matter what you order on the website, that is going to arrive in 1 or 2 days in almost every case, occasionally at most 3 days. So rapid shipping, staying cold, top quality with a screw cap, so that's been a change we've made. And I also wanted to quickly point out, this is another really awesome option, a way to experience our wine. You get 1, 2, or 3 bottles of our wine with our subscription box. This is our version of a wine club. You get 1, 2, or 3 bottles of wine a month with locally handcrafted gifts. Anything from locally handmade honey from our aunt, actually, to, you know, cool lit up bottles, charcuterie boards, wine bottle openers, resin jewelry, adult coloring books, or locally handmade candles. So that comes with wine. It's basically your normal wine club. Huge discounts. We actually do more than the normal wine club, which is usually about 20% off. We're doing more in the range of 30 to 40% off. It depends per month because we have a flat rate, but you get variable discounts between about 30 and 50% off the wine with our subscription box, free shipping, and locally handcrafted gifts. So it's an insane over-the-top amount of discounting. So you get really good deals in the wine, as well as all this cool local stuff. So that being said, you know, I think Jerome might have a last little bit of wine to talk about, or food pairing to talk about.
Yeah, I do. And one thing, you know, because I should have started up a second grill. That was the part I wasn't able to keep up with, is getting everything grilled. So I jumped right from, this is the tofu, put a little hoisin sauce on top of there, along with the cocoa, to kind of take the same note as it would have with the stone fruit. So this is your pairing for the Barbera. Mm-hmm. For the Zinfandel, and would it be possible for us to, like, walk this over the door to the show? Yeah. Because it's ready, but it's all on the grill right now. So I kind of want to show you what I have for that, because it's one that is a pretty standard food. It's almost like, you know, what you would have on a Philly cheesesteak minus the cheese, or what you would have with fajitas. I don't have any tortillas or bread with it, but it's the same combination of flavors and will work really well with this wine, because the L4, it is a pretty good barbecue wine. So, you got me there? Anyway, we can get a little bit of close-up on the grill.
That's probably the best part we can get.
All right, so, mobile grill! So what you see here is a bunch of mixed mushrooms. I put oyster mushrooms, king oyster mushrooms, shiitake, white button mushrooms, and all of them, I just drizzled the L4 Zinfandel over. Because that way, we having technical difficulties?
No.
Okay. Oh. It's going to pair really well with that same wine. And I left some of them in kind of bigger pieces so that they wouldn't fall through. You don't want fallen soldiers when you're grilling. The onions I kind of left in big slices because same reason. It's going to grill anyway. And also the peppers. This is a nice flank steak. You could use anything, brisket, hanger steak, anything with nice marbling, and just get a nice grill on that. These are all going to have those nice smoky, rich, earthy, umami flavors that'll work real well with the L4. So these are going to take a while longer. I'm going to wait until everything has a nice char on it. So they're not going to be ready for this tasting. It's going to be for us to enjoy after. But if you're interested in any of these, I could send you more details on the recipe. I know I put it on the website as well. But like I said earlier, this is one of many pairings that you can do with this. There's all sorts of things that'll play with these flavors. This is just one thing that came to mind for me. And always, if you use that wine in your cooking, it makes it a natural pairing. So I'm looking forward to this. Next time when we're actual tasting room is open, maybe you can enjoy some as well. But thank you for joining me out here. I'm going to roll back into place and keep this moving.
So actually, I'm just going to hop out here with Jerome. So, all right. So since this was a relaxed summertime barbecue and Jerome was busy on the grill, you know, normally we're the two on camera. So I figure it's fitting that we end our live feed with, you know, me joining Jerome out here next to his grill of amazing food. I've been too busy talking to eat much, so I'm in a beast mode on some of this food. I hope you guys are eating good at home and enjoying our wine. And thank you all for joining us once again for another one of these fun live virtual tastings. We will see you guys again next week. We have our Father's Day lineup next week. Order that. We can still ship it to you guys if you order it now. We'll see you next Saturday, Father's Day. We have bingo night the week after that. Cheers. Until then, thank you all.
Thank you, everybody.
Aaron. Thanks for joining us. Thank you, Mom, for joining us. Thank you, Carrie, for joining us. Thank you, all of you, for joining us.
Go. That's where you want.
We're going to eat good.
Doing all right?